I'm going to give you some examples of speed time dilation and gravitational time dilation. That's me standing next to the statue of Hendrik Anton Lorentz, here in the Netherlands, in his birthplace Arnhem. He determined the first formula for the speed time dilation. He also won the second Nobel Prize ever in 1902. So this is a very simple formula to calculate speed time dilation. You can also write it this way, with v squared over c squared, but that will give the same result. So we'll just keep it simple and use only this one. I'll start giving an example of the speed time dilation of the ISS, the International Space Station, and then the speed time dilation for GPS satellites orbiting at a much higher orbit, the Earth orbiting around the Sun, and for the solar system orbiting in the Milky Way, and the speed time dilation if you go close to the speed of light. You can click on one of these images to go directly to the calculation. And after that, I'll give you some examples of gravitational time dilation using the Schwarzschild vector, or metric as it is also called, starting with the different gravitational time dilation between a clock at sea level and the clock on the top of the Mount Everest, gravitational time dilation between the atomic clock at Boulder, Colorado in the USA in the mountains, and the atomic clock at Greenwich near sea level, and the gravitational time dilation for GPS satellites at a big distance from Earth, and the gravitational time dilation between Earth and the surface of the Sun, and the time dilation near black holes, and how it influences the development of the universe. You can also click here on the images to go directly to the calculation. So let's start with the speed time dilation of the ISS orbiting around the Earth. It orbits at 28,000 kilometers an hour, that is 7,800 meters a second. So the time will run slower on the ISS by a factor of 1.00 some zeros and then 338. If you do gamma minus 1, you see the difference of 0.0107 seconds a year, or 83.6 meters a year, because it's going at a speed of 28,000 kilometers an hour. That is only taking in consideration the speed time dilation. And now the time dilation for the GPS satellites orbiting around the Earth at a much higher orbit at 3,875 meters a second. And therefore, there's a time difference of 2.64 milliseconds a year. So that is 10.2 meters a year. That is only taking in consideration the speed time dilation. Later on, I'll tell you more about the gravitational time dilation. Now, the speed time dilation of Earth going around the Sun. The Earth is orbiting the Sun at 30,000 meters a second. So therefore, there's a time difference of 0.158 seconds a year. So almost 5 kilometers a year. And the solar system orbits in the Milky Way at a speed of 250,000 meters a second, and therefore there's a time difference of 11 seconds a year, or 7.5 kilometers a day. And now the speed time dilation if you go very close to the speed of light. If one travels at 99% of the speed of light, then there is a time difference of 6 years every 1 year. So if one would travel 1 year long at 99% the speed of light, then on Earth would have passed 6 years more, so 7 years. So these were the examples of speed time dilation. Before going to the gravitational time dilation, I'm going to show you how you can derive the formula for speed time dilation. Imagine there's a light bulb on the ceiling of a train, and there's a light ray going from the ceiling to the floor over a distance h. But for somebody standing still outside the train, the light ray would have traveled over a distance l, while the train advanced over a distance d. So we can use the formula h squared plus d squared is l squared. So considering that gamma is the time that passed for the observer standing outside the train at zero velocity, over the time that passed for somebody standing inside the moving train. Then you get gamma is 1 over the square root of 1 minus v over c squared. Choosing one reference frame to be at rest is arbitrary, but only the clock that first accelerated and then decelerated will really be behind. And moreover, the velocity v must always be smaller than c, the velocity of light, because you can't get the square root of a negative number. So the time dilation or the length contraction or the charge reduction is never bigger than 100%. Going faster than the speed of light implies a length contraction bigger than 100%. So going faster than the speed of light is physically impossible. That's only something for science fiction. The fact that time delays was discovered and proven a long time ago. Bruno Rossi was the first to really confirm the correctness of the formula. He measured the presence of muons in the atmosphere. Cosmic rays create muons and they decay very quickly. You can read his measurements down here. And now I show you how to calculate the gravitational time dilation. The German Karl Schwarzschild worked out the formula when he was in Russia during the First World War. He suffered from some rare scale disease and therefore he died at the age of 42, just 6 months after he sent his formula to Einstein, who integrated it into his theory of relativity. Here's the first example of the gravitational time dilation between a clock at sea level and a clock on top of the Mount Everest, which is ticking a slightly bit faster. So we put the height of Mount Everest into the formula, and then we see that the time is ticking faster by a factor of 1.000, again a lot of zeros, and then 965. So we see that there is a time difference of 30.5 microseconds, a millionth of a second a year. That means 1 second each 33,000 years. So every 33,000 years, a clock at sea level gets 1 second behind compared to a clock on the top of Mount Everest. There is an atomic clock at Boulder, Colorado, USA, at an altitude of 1,655 meters above sea level, and there's another atomic clock at Greenwich at an altitude of 46 meters above sea level. So therefore, there's a gravitational time dilation. If we put the altitude of the atomic clocks into the formula, then we can see that there is a time difference of 5.5 microseconds, millions of a second a year. So that is 1 second each 180,000 years. But then we oversee one important thing, the flattening of the Earth. The Earth isn't a perfect sphere. It's a little bit squeezed. It bulges slightly at the equator. There's a difference of the radius of the Earth at the equator and the poles of 21 kilometers. That's 0.3%. So looking at the latitude of Greenwich and Boulder, we see there's a difference in the radius of the Earth of 4.5 kilometers. We can also see that the Mount Everest is not the highest point of Earth, well, the highest point of Earth above sea level, but actually on top of the volcano Chimborazo in Ecuador, we are on the furthest point from the center of the Earth, and on the poles we find ourselves at the closest point to the center of the Earth. There's a time dilation of 1 second each 10,000 years between the top of this volcano and the poles. So if we take into account the flattening of the Earth, as Earth isn't a perfect sphere, we can put into the formula the right radius of Earth at Greenwich plus its altitude, and the right radius of Earth at Boulder plus its altitudes, and then we see that there's a time difference of 21 microseconds, millions of a second a year, equal to 1 second each 48,000 years instead of 1 second each 180,000 years if we don't take into consideration the flattening of the Earth. And now the time dilation of the GPS satellites orbiting around the Earth. I already showed you that there's a speed time dilation resulting in 10.2 meters a year. But now let's look at the gravitational time dilation on GPS satellites. The GPS satellites orbit the Earth at an altitude of over 20,000 kilometers. So there's a time difference of 1 second each 60 years. So that gives 64.7 meters a year at a velocity of 3,875 meters a second. So because of the speed time dilation, the satellites go slower by 10.2 meters a year. But due to the gravitational time dilations, they go 64.7 meters faster a year. So due to the time dilation, they go faster by 54.5 meters a year. Now let's see what's the gravitational time dilation between Earth and the surface of the Sun. The gravity force on the Sun is much bigger, so the time runs a little bit slower over there. So if we put into the formula the mass and the radius of the Earth, and the mass and the radius of the Sun, then we'll see that there is a time difference of 0.1823 seconds a day. So 1 second each 5.5 days. So every 5.5 days, a clock on the surface of the Sun gets 1 second behind compared to a clock on Earth. Ignoring the fact that it's quite difficult to put a clock on the surface of the Sun because it's slightly warm over there. The Earth is really small compared to the size of the Sun, but there are other suns that are much, much bigger than the Sun. Antares is almost 900 times bigger than the Sun, and the biggest sun we know, Canis Majoris, is 1,500 times bigger than the Sun. And then there are about 100 billion stars in our own Milky Way, and astronomers estimate that there are 100 billion galaxies with each 100 billion stars in the whole universe. So now let's see what is the gravitational time dilation if the Sun were 100,000 times heavier. So we multiply the mass of the Sun with 100,000, and then we see that there is a time difference of 0.32. So the time would run 32% slower on the surface of the Sun compared to a clock on Earth if the Sun were only 100 times heavier. So during every 4 days on Earth, there would pass only 3 days on the Sun. So if we look at the Big Bang, all matter was very close together, so the gravitational forces must have been huge, and therefore the time must have run infinitely slow and also must have been an infinite length contraction. As the time was running very slow just after the Big Bang, we could also call the Big Bang the explosion in slow motion. So these were 5 examples of gravitational time dilation in our Milky Way. Now let's have a look at the time dilation near a black hole. We use the same formula. The radius of a black hole is defined by 2gm, the mass of the black hole, over c squared. So 2gm over rc squared is 1. So if we put this into the formula above, we see 1 minus 1 gives 0. And the square root of 0 is 0, but you can't divide by 0. So let's say we are very close to the black hole. So we calculate 1 minus 0.999, an infinite number of 9s. And then we see that there is a gravitational time dilation that is infinite. So the time dilation is infinite and also the length contraction is infinite. So on the event horizon, that's on the edge of the black hole, the time dilation and length contraction are 100%. What goes on inside the black hole, we can only guess. The concepts of time and length do not exist inside a black hole. By the way, any form of energy slows down time. According to the theory of relativity, also heat, pressure and magnetic fields slow down time. But only for speed and gravity exist physical formulas. Actually, Michael Buckingham estimated that the energy difference of matter at a certain temperature is defined by this formula. But the formula is correct only in a small, very cold range just above the critical temperature at which matter becomes superconductive. You can see that the formula is similar to the two formulas above. Now, is time dilation the solution to dark energy and dark matter? As you can see, just after the Big Bang, matter was very close together, so the gravity forces were huge, and therefore the time ran very slow as I showed before. All galaxies are spread out evenly over the universe, and the interacting gravity forces are very weak, so time runs much faster now. So according logic, the time must have accelerated throughout the universe over time. I wrote this article about a possible explanation for dark energy and dark matter. If you want, you can press pause and read it all. I'm gonna give you only the highlights. So according to me, dark energy and dark matter could be both optical time illusions. Dark energy has a long-term time acceleration effect of a billion years expanding universe, and dark matter has a local time acceleration effect in and between galaxies. Also inside a galaxy, there's much more matter, so time runs slower over there, and more towards the outside of a galaxy, the interstellar gravitational forces are much weaker, so time must run faster over here. This also explains the Big Bang seems to have expanded faster than the speed of light. Actually, it was only time that ran much slower at the time. And it explains the homogeneity of the universe. It also means that more distant pulsars pulse faster on average, because the time accelerated and therefore also the frequency of the pulses accelerated. And likewise, distant quasars should be relatively brighter on average, because as time runs slower in the beginning, they build up a higher light concentration. The gravitational time dilation also explains the changing rotation speed of Mercury. When Mercury is closer to the Sun, the time runs slower and therefore Mercury also seems to rotate slower. I think I read we're talking about a variation of 9 seconds per rotation. The time dilation also gives an alternative explanation for the pioneer anomaly, and also for the moon receding contradiction, and the stellar movements inside galaxy arms, and also it gives an explanation for the origin of ice ages, and it gives an explanation for the different solar rotation speeds as the Sun rotates faster at its equator. I also translated this article into Dutch, my native language, and in German, I also speak German, and in Italian, the language I speak most of the time at home. I hope my video was useful for you. Comments below are welcome, and please subscribe to my channel.